never brings more troubles to me. I told my troubles to the river. She shared them with the seas. She returned them to me doubled. The river holds no offer of peace. I can wash this blood from my fingers. I can wash this stain from my soul. But I can't wash out your memories. The river returns them all. I told my troubles to the river. She shared them with the sea. Yeah, I told my troubles to the river. But the river brings them back to me. Yeah, the river brings them back to me. Yeah, the river brings them back.
I walk a lonely road, the only one that I have ever known. Don't know where it goes, but it's home to me, and I walk alone. I walk this empty street on the boulevard of broken dreams, where the city sleeps, and I'm the only one, and I walk alone. Somewhere in my mind, on the borderline of the edge, and where I walk alone. Read between the lines of what's messed up, and everything's alright. Check my vital signs and know I'm still alive, and I walk alone. Alone. And I walk alone, I walk alone. My shadow's the only one that walks beside me. My shallow heart's the only thing that's beating. Sometimes I wish someone out there will find me. Till then, I walk alone, I walk alone. walk this empty street on the boulevard of broken dreams, where the city sleeps, and I'm the only one, and I walk up. My shadow's the only one that walks beside me. My shallow heart, the only thing that's beating. Sometimes I wish someone out there. Just like ice, and there's a cold and lonely light that shines from you. You wind up in the wreck you hide behind that mask you use. And did you think this fool could ever win? Well, look at me, I'm a coming back again. I got a taste of love in a simple way. And if you need to know while I'm still standing, you just fade away. Don't you know that I'm still standing better than I ever did? Looking like a true survivor, feeling like a little kid. And I'm still standing after all this time, picking up the pieces of my life without you on my mind. I'm still standing, yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm still standing, yeah, yeah, yeah. Once I never could have hoped to win, you're starting down the road and leaving me again. The threats you made were meant to cut me down. And if my love was just a circus, you'd be a clown by now. Don't you know I'm still standing better than I ever did? Looking like a true survivor, feeling like a little kid. And I'm still standing after all this time, picking up the pieces of my life without you on my mind. I'm still standing, yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm still standing, yeah, yeah, yeah. Don't you know that I'm still standing better than I ever did? Looking like a true survivor, feeling like a little kid. And I'm still standing after all this time, picking up the pieces of my life without you on my mind. I'm still standing.
In times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. And in my hour of darkness, she is standing right in front of me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be, oh, let it be. whisper words of wisdom, let it be. And when the broken-hearted people living in the world agree, there will be an answer, let it be. For though they may be parted, there is still a chance that they will see. There will be an answer, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be. Oh, let it be. Yeah, there will be an answer, let it be. Let it be, let it be.
We ring this bell three times. The first is to call us into relationship with our ancestors. The second calls us into relationship with ourselves and one another, that we open ourselves. And the third calls us into relationship with our children and our children's children out to the seventh generation, helping us to realize what is our legacy.
Welcome to Mission Peak Unitarian Universalist Congregation. I'm Paul K. Davis. I will be worship associate this morning, and Mark Rahman is our worship leader this morning, while our minister is either exchanging pulpit or has his Sunday off once a month. I forget which, but good morning. He's in Portugal. Thank you, Don. Goodness. But he's still been sending emails out. Good morning, all. I am a scientist. I'm proud of my scientific career. I'm relieved that I live in a place and time in which scientists are respected instead of being burnt at the stake. An essential part of being a scientist is being a skeptic. So I recently purchased this book, A Skeptic's Guide to the Universe. Its first section describes a couple dozen common errors in how people think and reason. Alas, scientists are just as subject to these as non-scientists. Some years ago, the author, who adopted the name Mark Twain, recognized one common temptation among us when he wrote, quote, "Scientists have odious manners, except when you prop up their theories, then you can borrow money from them," unquote. Twain has identified the temptation, which in the skeptic book is called confirmation bias. We react differently to facts which prop up our theories than to those which undermine them. In the one case, we enter that fact into our storehouse of data for use in scientific papers and personal discussions. In the other case, we feel, as one anonymous scientist has been quoted, that it would be a pity to have new evidence come to light which would overthrow all the admirable scientific work of the past. Confirmation bias explains how two people with the same data available can each be convinced that the data proves their theory. This temptation occurs not only in scientific discussions, but also politics, religion, and many other aspects of life. It can have disastrous consequences. Early in my career at NASA, I was assigned to read the report on the erroneous manufacture of the Hubble Space Telescope primary mirror and avoid making that mistake again. Yeah, thank you, boss, for that assignment. I found that there had actually been three tests showing the mirror was figured wrong, and only one showing it to be perfect. That each of the three negative results was dismissed as a fluke, and the one result confirming that the team had done an excellent job was believed. Yeah. It's quite easy to be convinced by any collection of data available that I am right and you are wrong. So let the many cognitive biases not lead us into temptation, but let us worship together to strengthen our understanding of our own weaknesses. Please join with me in reciting these words which call us together as a community and with Unitarian Universalists across the globe. We light this chalice to remind ourselves to treat all people kindly because we are all one family, to take good care of the earth because it is our home, to live lives full of goodness and love because that is how we will become the best people we can be.
Good morning, everyone, both here in Cole Hall and on Zoom. Welcome to Mission Peak Unitarian Universalist Congregation. My name is Gail Tupper, and I'm a member of your board. We are so glad you've joined us here this morning. Unitarian Universalists are people who are all coming at truth from different paths. We gather together across different identities, experiences, and beliefs to affirm and promote the inherent worth of every person. I have two announcements that are great news this morning. I don't have an update on the Longfields yet, but we're all waiting with bated breath. But our own Deanna Alm, who is and has been on our board for a long time and is member at large, was member at large, has accepted the has agreed to complete the remainder of this fiscal year as our treasurer. So we now have a treasurer. Thank you, Deanna. Then, of course, when Deanna accepted the treasurer position, that left a member at large vacancy on our board. So Kathy Bain, who was on our leadership development committee, has accepted the member at large position. So we once more have all current board positions filled. Thank you, Kathy, for joining our board. And I know Kathy has signed up online. I'm not seeing her right on that screen. But thank you to both Deanna and Kathy. This was very important to complete our board for the rest of this year. My guess is we have an opening on leadership development now, but that will be followed up on later. If you are our guest for the first time, either here or online, we do welcome you. Here's a bit of information on how our hybrid services work. We use chat in our Zoom or on our book near the welcome table over there to share joys and concerns, any personal milestones of importance, which will be read aloud during the service. We also have a social hour after the service where we get to visit with one another, either in breakout rooms online or here on our patio. The worship host will give you more information about the breakout rooms online right after the service. I am also our welcoming rep today, and I will put a link to our weekly newsletter, Week on the Peak, so that you can see all the events coming up. We also put our welcome email, welcome@mpuuc.org, to request a newsletter or other information be sent to you. Please join anything that speaks to you. If you're here in person, I'll be at our welcome table where you can sign up for the newsletter or ask any questions you may have. We are so glad to be together with each of you today. Thank you for being here.
Good morning. I'm Kathy Wallcave, chair of the membership committee, and we have been asking, and a lot of people have graciously agreed to turn on their cameras if they're attending via Zoom. Now, I know that can be intimidating. However, to those of us in Cole Hall, you're really kind of small, and so we don't know if you've shaved or you have your makeup on, or if you perhaps might be wearing a pajama top. We can't tell. But we do notice your warm smile. It helps us feel connected to you. It helps you feel connected to each other. And it helps visitors to get a better sense of who we are by seeing faces and not blank screens. Now, Graham and Steve have switched the camera that we in Cole Hall will use to wave. So instead of looking at that one, we now get to look at that one. So let's all give each other a big warm wave of hello. And now I have to, there, I'm still looking. So thank you. May this small act of greeting each other help us all feel a sense of love and connection that we carry in our hearts throughout the week.
And now, our welcoming song. Hymn number 95, There Is More Love Somewhere. However you want to join in, please feel free. Even if we can't hear you.
How many of you are blamers? How many of you, when something goes wrong, the first thing you want to know is whose fault it is? Hi, my name is Brene. I am a blamer. Let me just tell you this quick story. So this is a couple years ago when I first realized the magnitude to which I blame. I'm in my house, I have on white slacks and a pink sweater set, and I'm drinking a cup of coffee in my kitchen. It's a full cup of coffee. I drop it on the tile floor. It goes into a million pieces, splashes up all over me. And the first, I mean, a millisecond after it hit the floor, right out of my mouth is this: "Damn you, Steve." Who is my husband? Because let me tell you how fast this works for me. So Steve plays water polo with a group of friends. And the night before, he went to go play water polo. And I said, "Hey, make sure you come back at 10, because, you know, I can never fall asleep into your home." And he got back like at 10:30. And so I went to bed a little bit later than I thought. Ergo, my second cup of coffee that I probably would not be having had he come home when we discussed. Therefore, and so the rest of that story is I'm cleaning up the kitchen. Steve calls, caller ID. I'm like, "Hey." He's like, "Hey, what's going on, babe?" "What's going on?" So I'll tell you exactly what's going on. I'm cleaning up the coffee that spilled all, like dial tone. Because he knows. How many of you go to that place when something bad happens, the first thing you want to know is whose fault is it? I'd rather it be my fault than no one's fault. Because why? Why? Because it gives us some semblance of control. But here, if you enjoy blaming, this is where you should stick your fingers in your ear and do the na-na-na-na thing, because I'm getting ready to ruin it for you. Because here's what we know from the research. Blame is simply the discharging of discomfort and pain. It has an inverse relationship with accountability. Accountability, by definition, is a vulnerable process. It means me calling you and saying, "Hey, my feelings were really hurt about this," and talking. It's not blaming. Blaming is simply a way that we discharge anger. People who blame a lot seldom have the tenacity and grit to actually hold people accountable, because we expend all of our energy raging for 15 seconds and figuring out whose fault something is. And blaming is very corrosive in relationships, and it's one of the reasons we miss our opportunities for empathy. Because when something happens and we're hearing a story, we're not really listening. We're in the place where I was, making the connections as quickly as we can about whose fault something was.
Okay, accountability and temptation and so on. And I'm sure there's some clever way I can reword this, but I haven't figured it out yet. So we take up a collection on Sundays for the simple reason that our purpose in gathering is for more than ourselves. We want to make sure that the ministries that we need, the ones that infuse worth and dignity into our children, our youth, our programs of learning and leadership, and our ministries of anti-oppression and our work in the larger world are in place to meet the needs of others. So don't succumb to the temptation to put off sending in your pledge because you don't want to blame yourself. That's what accountability is. Okay, do we have the slide on how to actually do it? Ah, there it is. No need for any blame, just you can donate, you can put your check in the mail, you can put your check through the door slot, you can pay online, you can have your bank do bill pay. There's no lack of ways to succeed in contributing to our congregation. We hope you will make a contribution toward these worthy causes by mailing your check at the addresses which is on the screen, et cetera, et cetera. Thank you. Mark, your turn again, I think. Introduce joys and concerns.
Yes. Masks are strange things to get used to. I'm so used to them, I forget to put them on. I'm so used to them, I forget to take them off. Joys and concerns. One of the things that allows us to find hope and meaning, especially in the hard times, is the love and support we show one another. If you have a joy or concern that by sharing with this caring community might bring the encouragement or resilience you are needing, please write it briefly now in the chat. If you are here in person and would like to place a stone for a joy or concern, you may do so while the music plays. If your need is personal, you can also send an email to our minister for a follow-up conversation.
Thank you.
These are the messages written in the book. And that is the joys and concerns we have today. We have one more stone that we place in for those joys and concerns, especially the concerns that we all hold in our heart and are too tender to tell. One last stone. We do care. Thank you. I have, over the last 20 years, learned a great deal. I have learned that from a surprising group of people, specifically those individuals identified as having a severe mental illness. My ideas of how the world worked have been challenged. I have had to rethink much. When first we are confronted by contrary knowledge, we double down, trying to explain everything by our prior assumptions. But eventually, that is unsatisfactory. One then has to go through a transition, a period of ambiguity and uncertainty. If successful, a new way of looking at a situation arises. I have learned to go into every situation, trying to see if there is a new way of looking at it now, rather than waiting for difficulties to arise before I try something new. I have learned about tenacity, the capacity to keep going, not only in the face of adversity, but in the face of no hope. The ability to get up every day, even though it's no better than the day before, is an incredible power. I have learned to listen rather than project. It was a great shock to me to find that I didn't know everything about somebody else to start with. It is much more useful to find out. It is much better to achieve what you need than rather what you want. It is much more useful to find how things really are than to try and force them to be the way you would like them. I have learned to listen for the thought and not just on the words. That just because I think I understand what the words mean does not mean that I am hearing what was intended. If I stretch myself, I can make myself available to hear the meaning rather than just what's in front of me. But most of all, I have learned about courage. To be able to face a day in pain, knowing that only frustration awaits you is incredibly inspiring. To face each day knowing that no one understands you, that you don't fit in, and that nothing seems to work is incredible. I only hope that I can show some small measure of what I see in them every day. So
you may be an ambassador to England or to France. You may like to gamble, you might like to dance. You may be the heavyweight champion of the world. You may be a socialite with a long string of pearls, but you're gonna have to serve somebody. Yes, indeed, you're gonna have to serve somebody. Well, it may be the devil, or it may be the Lord, but you're gonna have to serve somebody. You might be a rock and roll addict, prancing on the stage. You might have drugs at your command, women in a cage. You may be a businessman or some high degree thief. They may call you doctor or they may call you chief, but you're gonna have to serve somebody. Yes, you are, you're gonna have to serve somebody.
Serve somebody.
Well, it may be the devil or it may be the Lord, but you're gonna have to serve somebody. State trooper, you might be a young Turk. You may be the head of some big TV network. You may be rich or poor, you may be blind or lame. You may be living in another country under another name, but you're gonna have to serve somebody. Yes, you are, you're gonna have to serve somebody. Devil, or it may be the Lord, but you're gonna have to serve somebody.
Serve somebody.
You may be a construction worker working on a home. Might be living in a mansion, or you might live in a dome. You might own guns, and you might even own tanks. Might be somebody's landlord, you might even own banks, but you're gonna have to serve somebody.
Serve somebody.
You're gonna have to serve somebody.
Serve somebody.
Well, it may be the devil, or it may be the Lord, but you're gonna have to serve somebody.
Serve somebody.
Maybe a preacher with your spiritual pride. You may be a city councilman taking bribes on the side. You may be working in a barbershop, you may know how to cut hair. You may be somebody's mistress, maybe somebody's heir, but you're gonna have to serve somebody. Yeah, you're gonna have to serve somebody.
Serve somebody.
Well, it may be the devil, it may be the Lord, but you're gonna have to serve somebody.
Serve somebody.
Might like to wear cotton, might like to wear silk. Might like to drink whiskey, might like to drink milk. You might like to eat caviar, you might like to eat bread. You may be sleeping on the floor, sleeping in a king-size bed, but you're gonna have to serve somebody. Yes, indeed, you're gonna have to serve somebody. Well, it may be the devil, or it may be the Lord, but you're gonna have to serve somebody. You may call me Terry, you may call me Timmy. You may call me Bobby, you may call me Zimmy. You may call me RJ, you may call me Ray. You may call me anything, but no matter what you say, still you're gonna have to serve somebody.
Serve somebody.
You're gonna have to serve somebody.
Serve somebody.
Well, it may be the devil, or it may be the Lord, but you're gonna have to serve somebody.
Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. In the old days, temptation was easily defined as the seven deadly sins. For those of us who can never remember all seven of them at any given time, they are sloth, lust, gluttony, my favorite, wrath, pride, envy, and greed, driven mostly by endorphins or adrenaline. But there are other temptations that are more subtle. These ones we carry within ourselves rather than are delivered to us from outside. They can be very nasty because we do not always know they are there. They can be thoughts or feelings that seem perfectly natural in the moment, but they can betray us into causing harm without awareness. The temptations arise out of certain basic human needs. Such needs arise out of the evolutionary path humans have taken. We are creatures of our history, and the capacities that we have are for a different place and time. We are adapted to a savanna or near woodland environment. For much of the time that we were becoming human, we were the prey, not the predator. Today, we live in a very different environment. Today, those capabilities that helped us survive are not necessarily what we need. As illustration, we are able to learn a language without special effort. Yet some are not able to manage mathematics even after years of tedious study. Our brain has no module for math like it does for language, even though modern society requires knowledge of numbers to do well. In my model, there are five questions that are basic psychic needs that everyone has. At base is, who am I? What makes me who I am? What is my personality? The answers evolve through life. At any given time, there is a core that is truly us. If we are not sure of who we are, then how shall we know what to do with ourselves? Next is, where do I fit in? When we are born, a great number of conditions have already been set for us. What culture we are in, our geographic location, the social status of our parents, the era, and a whole host of other parameters that determine our situation. If who we are does not match where we fit in, then we shall have an internal conflict that is difficult to resolve. We may not be able to resolve it and remain in the same place we were born into. Thirdly, who are my connections? When first we arrive, there is, of course, our families. As we grow older, we will have friends. There will be those people with whom we voluntarily associate at work, in clubs, teams that we back, and any number of other ways that we connect to people. When a person begins to isolate and stop maintaining connections, it becomes a very dangerous time for them. There are few setbacks that are greater than when one is ostracized and others cut connections with them. Fourthly, we want to understand, what is our purpose? If we do not come to one of our own, then we may wander through life without direction. Some people find this sufficiently threatening that they accept a purpose that others assign them. Lacking purpose is akin to being adrift and feeling like life is meaningless. Something important is missing. Something that makes us a worthwhile human being. Lastly, why am I needed by others? What is it that makes me important in this world? What would be left undone if I were not here to do it? This is different from a purpose. We are needed by our families, but our purpose in life may be to put apple trees everywhere we can. All five of these things put together give us a sense of our own value. We need them all to be in some sense of order for us to feel like life is worth living. It is that need for keeping our lives valuable that we are tempted to do things. Things that feel very natural in the moment, things that may not go down well. There are things we do to protect our concept of self, who we feel we really are. One of those ways is to keep two sets of rules. And the beauty of it is that we think those two different sets of rules are the same one. The one for thee and the one for me. We are tempted to feel that we have treated others fairly and equally, even though they are held to different standards. The temptation is to believe that we are superior beings because we have come out on top. We feel that it is due to our own brilliance and not the fact that the game was rigged. Temptation two is to rationalize. In order to avoid admitting error that would lead us to having a lesser view of ourselves, we often rationalize decisions in order to justify what ultimately is wrong. What you come out with is something along the lines of, yes, it was wrong, but it was really right to do the wrong thing. When we are in danger of losing connection, then we are tempted to create the illusion of connection. There are many ways to do that. Join in rooting for a particular athletic team, then you are connected to the tribe that follows that team. Other people seek friendship and social media. And how many friends do you have on Facebook? It used to be axiomatic that one could not buy true friendship. But now on Facebook, you can buy friends by the tens of thousands. Other people are connected by video gaming, by Twitter followers, or a TikTok influencer. We are tempted to believe that this is a connection of friendship, even though we never sit down in the same place and never really know anything about the person. Has anyone ever said something along the lines of, "All right, who stole my glasses?" or "Who stole my book?" and then follow it up almost immediately with, "Oh, that's where I left it." This is all part of narrative creating. We create a storyline, a narrative in our heads to explain what our life is doing. The narrative is often quite at odds with the reality of the world, but that narrative helps protect who we feel we are and where we fit in. It was not that I was careless, it was someone else who was acting malevolently. Has anyone here ever had an active discussion in which the words "always" or "never" were used? Then you have engaged in narrative creating. Have you ever told someone else about a person so that they would already have an opinion of them? Then we are narrative creating. We are tempted to do this because it helps us feel we understand the world and what we should be and how we should be seen in a certain light. We have a sense of what is normal in the world that comes to us from how we grew up. It helps us understand how the world works for us, but we then extrapolate that to the rest of the world in order to not have contradictions of how the world works. How we grew up is what is natural to us. It is what we expect of the world as we go through it. It is strengthened by our tending to stay within an environment that agrees with that supposition. This fits in with the whole basic inclination that anything different is wrong. And so when we look at travelogues or National Geographic pictures of foreign lands, we see quaint individuals. But when we see them in our own land, in clothing that isn't like ours, speaking in a way that is not like us, we are tempted to think the less of them. What is normal is what is normal to us. Projection is the temptation to prove that we were right from the start. We project onto others that they should understand the world the way we do, even though it is obvious there are many different ways to understand the world. Many different languages, many different cultures, many different economic situations that are part of a different frame of reference. Stereotyping is a quick shorthand of understanding the world that does not require evidence and is designed to verify everything we already thought. If we do happen to make acquaintance with someone who is a counterexample to our stereotype, the easy thing to do is declare they are an exception. Then we do not have to re-examine the stereotype. We may remain comfortable that our internal understandings are protected. There may have been a time when stereotyping the behavior of lions and hyenas and stampeding wildebeests was useful knowledge for staying alive. That time has passed. We respond to the world, to events and situations that we experience through emotions. Conscious or unconscious perception of threats to our understanding of our core being are first met with an emotional response. We are inclined to let our emotions do our thinking for us. And some of what we are tempted to do in order to protect our core understanding is to avoid anything that might bring up a threat to our concept of who we are. We can avoid by leaving, by having recourse to the silent treatment, or by starting a fight in order to change the subject. One can avoid by procrastinating. One can avoid by never trying in the first place. Then you do not have to confront the fear that maybe you aren't capable in the first place. An excuse as to why there is no reason to try can always be found. When there is uncertainty to be found, and the outcome may influence your view of yourself, then the easy solution is to substitute certainty for not knowing. The cost of the fear of the unknown is so great that people will twist themselves into a pretzel in order to feel secure by being certain. The potential for harm is obvious, but the security of the inner self seems more important than living with the fear of the unknown. In our search to validate that we are persons of value, people who matter, there are certain shortcuts. Because of our station in life, because of what history has given us, it may be very difficult to prove both to ourselves and to an outside world that we are individuals of substance. We would like to be able to say that we are better than the average, which would verify that we are worthwhile. We could do things that are estimable, but that can be difficult. Much quicker is to prove that we are better than others, much quicker is to prove not that we are better than others, but they are less than we. And in so doing, we do not have to provide any evidence that we are of any value whatever. Simple and expedient when it comes to avoiding any inspection of one's own self is simply passing judgment. In order to verify the relative value scale that makes us feel better, all we have to do is find something about someone upon which we can pass judgment. The thing need not be rational, real, or important. We need only show that we are absolutely certain about it, and that it justifies considering that I am a person of value because I have shown someone else to be lesser. If I can use an existing theme that is current in society, it is much easier to have the judgment accepted. If one is feeling a little more confident than one may use as an objective criteria of comparison, whatever parameter in one's own life is one's own best. Strong people, fast ones, smart ones, rich ones, famous ones, whatever one's talent, that becomes the measure to give oneself the best chance in a comparison. This will likely be corroborated by other members of the groups who share the same parameter. There is an old joke about when times are difficult and all is falling into ruin, the man who is smiling has thought of someone to blame. Blame absolves oneself at the same time that it points attention towards someone else. Blame is different from responsibility. Blame carries with it an aspect of malignant intent. Blame, like judgment, is simple to perpetrate and works best when there is an existing weakness to go after. Pejorative language is to be preferred to evidence. What if, after all efforts, I am not feeling good about myself? I can borrow somebody else's value. People who can join up with a tribe or a company may ascribe to themselves the qualities that are presumed for that tribe or company. People in the lower rungs of management generally identify closely with the power of the company, even though companies have never been known to care much about lower management. It is part of trying to gather for themselves the best estimation of who they are and what they are worth. And if you identify as a Giants fan, well, then you are well aware that all Dodgers fans are dirt. If succumbing to the first temptation is not successful, then often further efforts are added in. If avoiding does not get people off your back, then move on to rationalizing. Thereafter, you can move to blame if things get serious. All the temptations come about in order to protect the important psychic needs that human beings have, to protect my concept of who I am, to ensure that I will always fit in, to keep my connections, believing in me and allow me to believe in what I feel is my purpose in life and why I am needed. Many of them occur without our notice or serious reflection. I would like to propose a substitution for the old seven deadlies. In place of sloth, lust, gluttony, still my favorite, wrath, pride, envy, and greed, I would like to propose the following substitutions. The list should now include blame, judgment, shame, certainty, control, entitlement, and pity. All of these are part of what I have been talking about today, and all of them cause harm to those we know and love. They give the illusion of safety in a world that can never be guaranteed. I wish I had answers as to how we can all easily become better human beings. It is because it is so easy to become worse people that it is difficult to counteract. It is built into us to do things out of fear or shame that hurt. To overcome what we do not necessarily see in the moment takes work and a willingness to be in uncomfortable places. First step is to identify the problem. I hope I have made some small effort at that today. Next is mindfulness, a specific type that focuses on relationships. Relationships to people you are close to those you are acquainted with, and those you may only meet in passing. Slow down. Look at events and situations and not the presumptions about the person. Use purely descriptive language to describe to yourself what is happening. Mindfulness is a skill and skills must be practiced. You will not be proficient immediately. Search for the effect you are having on another. Answering the five questions I put out to your own satisfaction may help you feel less vulnerable to threats to your core. Being secure in your own being will help all aspects of life. And may it be so. And I believe now we have hymn 169.
We shall overcome.
Please join with me in reciting these words with which we extinguish our chalice. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again.
Friends, place one hand on your heart, and with the other, reach out to your family, friends, neighbors, and all the world. Be brave, be adventurous, take chances. Love yourself that you may love others. See the world in a new way. Amen.